Thanks for tuning in to the TV Pet Show. I'm Kathy Covey, your host. Let me ask you, are you prepared? After Katrina, practically everybody had a 72-hour kit. Where is your kit now? With me is Cynthia Valdivia, the Public Health Emergency Preparedness Program educator for Washington County. Together, we're going to make sure you and your pet are prepared for any weather event or any disaster that may come. Welcome, Cynthia.
Thank you, Kathy. I'm so glad to be here with you.
The first thing I want to talk about is how to build your kit. What are you going to put it in, and what are you going to put into it?
Okay. Well, that's one of my favorite topics, Kathy. I spend a lot of time talking to the public, and I find that people think they have to have everything or not put together a kit at all.
Okay.
And it really isn't all or none. You know, you can have some pieces. Something's better than nothing.
Sure.
So I have some different things to show you here. This is very, very minimal. This is something that would be great to have in your briefcase or have in the car, in the glove box. Basically have it with you all the time if that's the only thing that you can put together and afford.
What is in this?
This is a deluxe kit from the Red Cross, and it has a poncho, light stick, a couple of first aid things, a mask, a whistle, some water, some very basic things. And obviously it's not everything that you need.
Sure.
But really, it's difficult to put together everything that you need. So there are different stages, and it doesn't all have to be done at one time in
okay.
one day. I actually did that. I went around to stores to find out how long it would take me to put together a kit from scratch. It took me 12 hours, 16 stores, and $140 to do it all in one day.
That's the 72-hour kit.
Right, okay. Just for 72 hours.
So let's talk about some of these different containers you have and what they're good for.
Okay. Again, there are lots of different companies. I have a couple of things from the Red Cross just because we managed to get these from them. This is a very small kit. As you can see, it's very compact, almost looks like a first aid kit, like
yes.
you thought it was a first aid kit. And it has more than this, but is the very basic core of what would go into a kit. Sometimes it's easier to start with something like this.
Okay.
And add that into a backpack or a carry-on suitcase with wheels, that type of thing.
Okay.
It's can be less expensive to start with the core of
so
it
this,
here.
So this has drinking water, it has a flashlight in it.
It has food bars, it has first aid things, has a blanket and a poncho, a whistle, personal hygiene products. It actually has quite a bit of things for being so small.
For one person.
For one person
for
3 days.
3 days, okay. Mm-hmm. And then you're gonna move up to this size?
Yes, if you can. What I did was I actually bought one of the basic kits. I have multiple kits, as you can imagine. So I have a kit at home and by the door,
okay.
you know, which is a go bag type of thing. And I have one of these in my car.
Yes.
I have one of these at my desk.
Okay.
And I always travel with one of these. So one of these goes in my carry-on, it goes in my suitcase.
Okay.
I don't go anywhere without a kit because I never know what's going to happen or where, and I don't want to be part of the problem.
Exactly.
Yeah, I want to be able to help people out, and unless I take care of myself first, I really can't help anybody else out.
And that truly is the goal of being prepared. So when you have a kit this big, you can start including some more personal items in it, right? Some,
exactly.
some things, and maybe even get to including some pet items or using this to create your own pet kit as well.
Right. Well, my pet has her own kits, and she has
yes.
one that she has to carry herself. And I also have, it's like a carry-on bag with wheels that has some of her other stuff in it. Because, you know, carrying stuff for myself is really all I can do comfortably.
Sure.
And feasibly sure. for a while. So what I did was I added my own personal things to this. So adding, you know, the blanket that I use that is a comfort thing for me, some of the comfort items, things like socks and a change of clothes and those types of things. This kit, this bag is big enough to fit a little bit of that
Great.
In here.
So you did say some of the places that you could store it, by the door, have one in your car, one in your desk. What do you do about maintenance of this? Because if you're going to put water or food in these,
mm-hmm.
What would be the cycle to make sure that it stays fresh?
Well, that's also one of the advantages of buying a kit like this. The shelf life of this water is 5 years.
Wow. Okay.
And so it's a lot less hassle to try and change this out.
Yes.
You know, it It's kind of a trade-off. It does have a little bit of a different taste to it, but in a life and death situation, are you really going to care that much?
True.
And that's true of the food, too. This has a 5-year shelf life, and this is actually food. It's enough calories for one adult for 3 days. So it is very compact.
That is very compact.
For me, you know, it's about the portability and practicality of it more than the taste and, you know,
sure.
There are really amazing gourmet things that you can buy that are disaster food. But for me, it's about being able to grab something quickly and get out quickly because I'm expected to respond at the county. You know, I'm expected to be there to be able to help other people. And so I'm not going to have time to cook and do all those things anyway.
Yeah.
So at home, of course, you know, my stay home kit is completely different. Except for that it contains a lot of the same things, but different types of them. This is not the kind of food that I have in my home kit.
No, I wouldn't imagine.
I have real food in my home kit.
So when you migrate from, you know, first let me back up. We wanted to make sure that the people are prepared for themselves. And then if you have a pet, we want to make sure that you also include some things for your pet. And I do have a couple items here that people, you know, just the basics that you would want to make sure that you have. Enough food so that your pet will be comfortable. This is about a 7-pound bag, so this might not be what you would take for 72 hours. It's definitely, this is about enough to feed a cat for a month. We've got some canned food as well, bowls for your kitty, and then something to house your kitty in. This is something that you could use temporarily. This is probably not the best thing. We'll talk about the best item here in just a little bit. And always making sure that your pet has a collar with identification on it, because
absolutely,
you never know what's going to happen. And these things, your own pet has its own kit, so these things can be put into another backpack or even into the carrier as well.
Right.
Wonderful. So we've got the basics of how to be prepared. And when we come back, we will go a little bit further into this.
Great.
Know where your pet hides when stressed or scared. In an emergency situation, that is where he or she is most likely to be and the first place you should look. Train your dog to come right to you with a very simple and firm command. Learn how to safely yet firmly scruff your cat to place in a carrier or use a pillowcase as a safe and secure temporary way to get your cat out of harm's way. Since Hurricane Katrina, the federal government encourages pet owners to be prepared to evacuate with their pet. Take a look at this.
Being prepared for an emergency means thinking about the needs of all the members of your family, including pets. Take a few minutes to check out the information on ready.gov specifically addressing tips and tools for pet owners. As you put together supplies for your family's emergency kit, be sure to think about the well-being of your pets. Include food, water, and medicine to sustain your pets for at least 3 days. Visit ready.gov for a complete list of suggested items, along with recommendations for how to prepare an emergency plan that includes your pets. Remember that pet food and medicines can spoil, so check your kit regularly to make sure everything in it is still fresh. In the case of an emergency, you may be able to stay in your home or you may have to evacuate. It's important to have a plan for either situation. If your family and pets have to wait out a storm or other disaster at home, identify a safe area of your home where you can all stay together. Put your emergency supplies in that room ahead of time, including your pet's crate and supplies.
The single most important thing you can do to keep your pets safe is to take them with you if you have to evacuate during a disaster. Oftentimes, people think their pets will be more comfortable or somehow safer at home. This is not the case. We've seen so many situations where people think they're going to be gone for a couple of hours, and then you are not allowed to go back to your home for days or sometimes even weeks. What's going to happen to your pet if you leave them behind?
Consider checking with your local animal shelter or emergency management office to determine if a pet-friendly emergency shelter will be set up near your location. Many emergency shelters only allow service animals, so advanced planning is key. Make a list of boarding facilities and veterinary offices that might be able to shelter animals in disaster emergencies. Include 24-hour telephone numbers. Another way pet owners can be prepared is by developing a buddy system.
With a buddy system, what you're doing is you're making arrangements with your neighbors and friends to, in case of a disaster, that you'll take care of each other's pets. So if you're not available to get your pet from your house, one of your buddies will be able to go into the house and get your pet.
A pet inside sticker is an effective tool for alerting first responders that there are pets inside your home. Your pet should be wearing up-to-date identification at all times.
It's extremely important that your pets are identifiable. So you want to make sure that all your pets have collars, and on those collars you want to have tags that have your name, your address, your cell phone number is extremely important.
It may also be helpful to put the phone number of an out-of-town relative on there, just in case you're not able to be reached in the event of a disaster.
Microchipping is a particularly effective way to identify pets separated from their owners in an emergency.
Getting your pet microchipped is really crucial to keeping them safe in a disaster situation. A microchip is a small device that can be implanted painlessly under your pet's skin, and it can be very inexpensive as well. If you're separated from your pet in a disaster situation, they might lose their collar and they might be taken to a shelter that's far away from where you live. At one of these temporary shelters, it would be very easy to swipe a scanner over your pet's microchip and all of your contact information will pop up, making it much more likely for you to reunite with your pet.
There are many things to consider when preparing your family for an emergency. By taking the time to also consider the needs of your pets, you can have the peace of mind knowing that even the smallest members of your family will be ready.
After seeing many sad situations where people left their animals behind, it's really wonderful to see people making pets an integral part of their disaster planning process.
With a little bit of planning, you can make a big difference and you can keep everybody, including your pets, safe.
Check out the information for pet owners on ready.gov and get started preparing today.
Wiffle is an outgoing, playful, and affectionate lady. She'd be happy to participate in whatever interests you. Want to play? She's there. Want to sit on the couch and watch a movie? She's there. This girl is friendly, social, and not at all demanding. She enjoys cuddling with you and will make a wonderful family cat.
Now that you have your kit and a buddy prepared to help you with your pet, let's talk about how you can get your pet out of harm's way. Let's focus on cats for just a second here. The big thing that you're going to want to do is learn how to scruff your cat with purpose so that you can get your cat out of its hiding place and into a kennel. I've got a wire kennel here that can be used as a travel kennel or as a temporary home for your pet once you get to where you're going to go. This one would be great for a small kitty, like this little kitty here, but if you have a bigger kitty, you're going to want to get a bigger kennel. I've got a huge kennel that I use for my cats. It's actually a dog crate. We've had a shelf put into it, got a place for a litter box, the water, place for them to sleep, and for one of them to get up on top of the shelf to get out of the way. Fits into the back of my car, fits great into a hotel room. So when you get your kitty out, get it into a carrier, get it into where you're going to go. Make sure that you have all your supplies that we talked about earlier, some food, the water bowls, maybe some canned food. Make sure your kitty definitely has ID on it. So when you get a dog out, it's a little bit of a different scenario. With a cat, you can scruff and go, but with a dog, you got special considerations. Cynthia, you have trained your dog to evacuate with you pretty quickly, haven't you?
I have. We've gotten it down to just over 5 minutes.
Wow.
For me to get my pack, get her pack, get her pack on her, and get out the door.
And how did you do this?
Well, my dog is very playful. She will play until she absolutely, literally drops. So it was difficult. I had to teach her to focus, and so I actually have a hand signal that if she's running around being her crazy usual self, I tell her focus, and she knows that I mean business. So if she's out playing somewhere, I also have a command that also she knows that she needs to come back immediately. And that is a special command. And this comes with training. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just, it doesn't happen automatically. And with some dogs, it takes more training than others.
Yeah.
But it's definitely worth it because it's kept her out of harm's way more than once. So not just for getting her out in a disaster, but also keeping her safe in day-to-day activities.
So it's a focused command. She knows you don't mean any, you don't mean play, you don't mean come when you think.
Right.
You mean come here now, we got business to
exactly.
take care of.
Exactly. So I tell her focus, and I bought this pack. Obviously this isn't 72 hours because she's a 60-pound dog.
No.
This is not 72 hours for her, but it is enough for us to be able to get out of harm's way and have something for her.
Okay. So, and what do you have in the dog pack?
Okay. Well, I didn't start out putting this on her with anything in it. So once I got the dog pack, what I did was the command is pack, and so she stands still for me to put her pack on.
Okay.
And we started out with it completely empty, and she bucked like a bronco. She was not happy. She was very, very upset, but we worked with that, and you know, I just ignored her tantrum and mm-hmm. took her for a walk and gradually extended it. And so then from there, I started adding things a little at a time, and now it weighs about 4 pounds.
Okay.
So in the pack, I have some packets of the water, you know, with a 5-year shelf life. This is something I keep in my pack for both of us. This is a Life Straw. It's a water filtration. So if we had to use puddle water, we actually can. Hopefully
not,
it won't come
worry.
To that,
yeah,
right?
Not worry
about
it.
That. But along with that, so if I have to get water from a kind of a suspicious source, she also has, this is a Camelback.
Okay.
And so she can carry water for both of us if she needs to. And I also, as you mentioned, collar and ID is really important. This is a high-vis collar that she doesn't usually wear. She has another collar, but I have a high-vis one for this pack. And also some comfort items. In addition to the water, there's mm-hmm. the food, her most favorite treat, thing she likes more than anything else.
And the ball.
And the ball. This is not just for play, but this is something that she chews on, and you know, when she's stressed, she just chews on it.
Okay.
So that takes care of those needs. And again, back to the practicality of it, you know, this is a water dish or food dish that's collapsible, unbreakable, easy to carry around. But probably the most important thing in this kit is, and usually I have the another kit for her with a laminated copy of this.
Yes.
And so this is her photo ID, my contact information. Even though she has a microchip in her, if it can't be scanned, that could be an issue.
Exactly.
So I want to make sure that her information is available. This is my identification, how to contact me, her vet's name, and on the other side, her medical records. So record of all of her shots and everything that she has. You know, she's healthy, so she doesn't have any meds, but that would definitely go on here too for a pet that has special needs.
I have a similar thing for my cats. It's a laminated card that has their picture on it that I carry in my wallet. So I have it, proof that they're my cats.
That is so important.
People also suggest that you take a picture with your pet.
Exactly.
And you keep that so that you can show that this is my pet.
Right. If you have a picture of you with your pet, as you said, that's even more important because there are so many pets that look like, you know, how many dogs look like this? I go to the park and see her everywhere. So that is a very important piece. The other thing that I have in here is a first aid kit and also some hygiene things. So I have her little poop bags in here and, you know, I jammed some first aid items. And I always try and find things that have multiple uses. And this is kind of an unusual thing, but this makes an excellent bandage. And it's multi-use. But so those are some of the things that I carry for her.
Well, and the theme is the same, whether it's a dog or a cat or a bird or a rabbit or a rodent, to make sure that you have the things that your animal needs to survive, the basic things to survive, some comfort items, and in a way that you can carry them. With a dog, you can definitely train a dog to carry their own, or at least carry some of them. With a cat, this is why I have the kennel already prepared. I have things in the kennel, so I take it, and I just have to find the cats where they're hidden, and we're ready to go.
Right. Wonderful. Remember, if it's not safe for you to stay, it's not safe for your pet either.
Exactly.
And if you take the time to plan ahead, it makes such a difference. You know, planning today can keep you safe tomorrow.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Dr. Nicole Putney, and this is Precious, and we're here with your pet health tip of the day. Fleas can be a real nuisance to you and your pet. And they're very prevalent in the Pacific Northwest, even in the winter. So it's really important to use once monthly topical flea preventative from your veterinarian. Things like Advantage, Revolution, Frontline are all very good products. Please don't use over-the-counter products because they can be poisonous to cats at times, and they can also be very ineffective, as are flea collars. Another way to get fleas off of your pet is to flea comb them, which gets the live fleas. However, it will not get the larvae, which can often be a problem even after live fleas are removed.
Being prepared can take just a few minutes, and it's a great insurance that your family and pet will be safe. Thanks so much, Cynthia, for being here with me today to give my viewers the tools and tips to keep themselves safe and their pets safe.
Thanks so much for inviting me, Kathy. I was glad to be here.
Now, you can get more information about emergency kits and special considerations for your pet at catadoptionteam.org/petshow. Thanks for watching the TV Pet Show. I'm Kathy Covey, and I'll see you next time.